forward to the message that he will bring. I believe it's from Galatians 1:8.
Actually, they've asked me to preach the second message.
The second one.
First.
Okay.
Soli Deo Gloria, to the glory of God alone.
To the glory of God alone. All right. Brother Spencer, you can come forward. We're still waiting on the interpreter.
Okay.
So if you have a word or two you'd like to say.
Okay, certainly.
Thank you, David.
Yes.
Of all the introductions that I've ever received, that is certainly the most recent. Thank you. I see Melody is here now, and they asked me to preach as fast as possible to make it as hard for her as I could. So this is a little close to me. I tend to speak loudly, so it doesn't have to be quite that close. Okay, Melody, are you ready back there? Okay, very good. The glory of God is one of the grandest themes of Scripture. The term glory appears over 400 times in the King James Version of the Bible. Sometimes it refers to men, such as Pharaoh and his proud boasting, but the predominant use of that term speaks of God. Men usurp the glory of God with their puny arrogance. But when God shows forth his glory, especially in the glory of the Shekinah, the earth wilts and burns. The message that has been assigned to me for this hour is entitled, Soli Deo Gloria, Glory to God Alone. The first two questions in the Westminster Catechism focus on the glory of God. Question number one, what is the chief end of man? Answer, man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Question two, what rule hath God given to direct us how we may glorify and enjoy him? Answer, the word of God, which is contained in the scriptures of the Old Testament and New Testaments, is the only rule to direct us how we may glorify and enjoy him. Indeed, not only man, but all of creation was made by our Creator to bring glory to God, to give him praise and honor and glory, and someday God will prophetically guarantee that it will happen. In that heart-pounding, knee-rattling, awe-inspiring throne room vision of Revelation chapter 4, Christ appears on his throne of glory, and we hear the voice of 24 elders roaring out a paean of praise. The 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne, and worship him that liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things, and for Thy pleasure they are and were created. Amen. What a magnificent scene to open the heavenly courts of eternity. And how well it portrays the glory of God. And what an introduction for our study today. The text that I've chosen for this address comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. Whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. This is a brief text, but it's filled with intense obligation. Understand, this is about our obligation that affects every area of our lives. It affects the ordinary things of our life, like eating and drinking listed in the text. It affects the extraordinary things, even the heroic things that God sometimes calls us to do. It affects the hard things. It affects the easy things. It's
a challenge to courage, a challenge to stamina. It's a call to rely on divine strength and guidance. It's a command that we put ourselves second and put God first. It's an obligation to develop the divine order of priorities. That leads to two basic questions. Number one, what areas of life does this command cover? And two, what interpersonal relationships are affected when we do all for the glory of Christ? Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. That affects our scheduled activities. It affects the unscheduled crisis times in our lives. It affects our chosen actions and our reactions when we're taken by surprise. It causes us to assess the temporal nature of life. It gives us focus to make the most beneficial choices and to always choose the best over the good. It affects all of the conscious choices we make in life and habits that we specifically and knowingly develop. But it also affects all of our involuntary and unconscious habits as well. It challenges us to sit up and reevaluate our purposes and our goals. It sometimes causes us to change our life direction. It sometimes directs us to enter into a different door than the one that we thought we should take. It demands that we eliminate the unnecessary and trivial things in life. It causes us to focus on the things of heaven rather than on the things of earth. It causes us to look both through the telescope of the future and the microscope of our present life. It causes us to act on the basis of eternity, where things last forever, rather than on the basis of time, where it all passes away. Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. That indeed challenges us to assess our time and its use. It confines and at the same time expands what we can legitimately do with the fleeting minutes and the fleeting resources that God has entrusted to our care. It determines the nature and the timing of our relationships. It determines the depth of our relationships. It determines the length of the relationship and whether we should bring a relationship to a close, no matter how painful. It may cause us to deepen a relationship if it makes us more effective in bringing glory to God. It determines the specific group of people that we choose to develop into friends. It determines our choice of a life partner. It determines the timing of entering into marriage. Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Indeed, that's a command that determines what we provide for our families, what we allow them to do, and the choices we make for those who are under our authority. It engages us in our education, our occupations, our hobbies, our free time, our activities, our entertainment, our responsibilities. It determines what we do in public and what we do in secret. It determines the legitimate and illegitimate exercise of authority. It teaches us submission to a higher authority. It teaches us when, where, how, and what, and to whom to give, and from whom to withhold our giving. Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. That's a command that teaches us to act like Jesus, to study Him so that we might know how to move in a sinful world without being polluted by it. It teaches us to seek wisdom, which is the principal thing. It teaches us to read and study the Scripture. It requires us to learn the specific facts of Scripture that we might understand God and His will for our lives better. It teaches us to learn the Bible's commands and prohibitions, its principles and its priorities, so that we can maximize the glory of God in our interactions with the world around us. It teaches us to pray. How to pray. How to persevere in prayer. The requests to make and the requests not to make. When to pray, for whom to pray, and for whom not to pray. When a believer commits is to send unto death, it says, I do not say you should pray for him.
Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God.
It teaches us how to interact with other people, both with the lost and with brothers and sisters in Christ. It teaches us how to stand against apostasy. It teaches us to be compassionate, how to be compassionate, to whom to be compassionate. It teaches us how to fight the spiritual warfare. It teaches us to be valiant. It teaches us to live or die for Christ, but never to compromise. It teaches us to be unashamed of the gospel of Christ. It teaches us to witness. It teaches us to be courageous enough to confront a sinning brother in love and humility. It teaches us the meaning of sacrifice. It teaches us to die to self. It teaches us to earnestly seek the will of God. It teaches us to put the will of God before our own will. It teaches us to defer to others and to exercise Christian charity. Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Oh, yes, there's more. Doing all for the glory of God affects not only our overt actions, but it also affects the things that we choose to avoid and the things we refrain from doing. It affects not only our personal speech, but to whom we speak, where we speak, when we speak, the content of our speech, the tone and volume and intensity of our speech, the expressions and body language that we exhibit when we are speaking, the words that we choose to use in each context, the avoidance of words and terms that reveal the flesh, the words that would uncover the seven deadly sins in our lives of anger, pride, envy, lust, sloth, gluttony, and greed. It informs and controls the minimal times when we actually refrain from speaking for the right reasons. Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. There's an even deeper level. The glory of God is the standard for what we are allowed to think. The times we are allowed to think those thoughts, it prohibits certain thoughts, it commands certain thoughts, it organizes and categorizes our thoughts. When we commit our works unto the Lord, He establishes our thoughts. Doing all for the glory of God moderates and tempers our thoughts. It releases certain thoughts in the expressive modes of our speech and actions at precise points in time. Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. On this deeper level, a focus on the glory of God also determines our attitude. Even when we are not speaking or acting, it mandates that we must have the divine viewpoint on all the events of life, on all the people with whom God brings us in contact, on all the circumstances of life in which we find ourselves. In other words, doing all for the glory of God forms our world view. It determines our weakness to avoid the appearance of evil. It monitors whether we're causing a weaker brother to stumble. And thus it determines what we wear, how we wear it, the times at which we wear it, the places at which we wear it, the kind of music that we listen to, the forms of music we focus on and allow to shape our personalities, the sensual versus the spiritual nature of our music. It determines how we choose to avoid the appearance of evil in the places we go and the people with whom we enter into those places. It makes us sensitive to our culture and the maintenance of our Christian testimony, both to the lost and to other believers. And whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God.
Amen.
And yes, as is specifically stated in the text, it determines what we eat, how much we eat. Oh, that's one for some of us. When we eat, how our eating habits will affect our bodies, which are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Whether we fast and for how long.
If we are fasting, it will determine the purpose of our fasting, whether it is for a godly purpose or merely an attempt to lose weight and look svelte. It will determine what we drink, how much we drink, the context in which we drink, the wisdom of what we drink. Will any of this glorify God, or were we merely acting with a stiff spine, a puffy face, and an attitude insisting on our perceived rights? Not neutral. God calls us to the positive glorification of Himself in everything that we do. It is not neutral. You make a choice. It is either for the glory of God or it is for the satisfaction of your flesh. Whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. That command determines our level of love to the Lord Jesus Christ and the Heavenly Father as we seek to love Him fully. It drives us to seek the areas where our love is weak or non-existent. It compels us to hunger and thirst for righteousness. It causes us to examine ourselves with relentless and unstoppable honesty as we seek to eradicate sin from our lives. It not only determines the external appearance of life, but, and here's a deeper level yet, our internal motives. Motives. How many good things we do for the wrong motives. And how we fail to understand that no matter how good our external actions, if our motives are wrong, it is not for the glory of God. How often motives become the ship that's lost in a storm of selfish, carnal, covetous, proud, slothful, lustful, angry, envious, gluttonous, personal focus. Motives. Tangled in the swamp of slimy personal interest, regardless of the will of God. How often has an apparently impeccable life that looks like it's being lived for the glory of God been wrecked on the rocks of wrong motives? Whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God.
Amen. Amen.
Do you get it? That means there are no areas that are private. There are no R&R areas where you can kick off your shoes, let down your guard, and just sloth about. There are no areas where you can be loose and slack and let boys be boys. There are no jobs where you can say, it's good enough for government work. There are no areas that are off limits. There are no closets where you can stash secret sins and personal pets. There is no corner that God may not enter. There are no neutral zones. Am I talking too loud, Stephen?
Too fast.
All right. I will slow it down. Not quite that slow, though. There is no corner where God may enter. There are no neutral zones. There are no places where you can put a do not enter sign directed at God. There is never an area that can be declared a no man's land to God. There are no boundaries where you can say, stop, verboten. Doing things for the glory of God does not apply here. No. Do all to the glory of God. Friends, that's serious business. I think a lot of us don't take God seriously when we hear those words. I think that there are going to be a lot of us that are going to be rattled out of our booties when we stand before Jesus Christ at the judgment seat. And so what does it mean to do all to the glory of God? How do we approach the question when it covers all of life? What's the first handle that we can grab onto? Paul gives us a hint in Colossians chapter 3, verse 23. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. Verse 17 gives further insight. And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. There are two keys in verse 23. It says, do it heartily. That means do it enthusiastically. Do it with your heart. There is no room for dragging your feet when you are doing something for the glory of God. There is no room for claiming that you are glorifying God with a scowl on your face. There is no room for sullenness and resistance or bitterness that God is making you do something that you'd rather not do. When you're in the center of God's will, that should cause you great joy. Listen carefully. When you are glorifying God, you are in the center of God's revealed will, because he has commanded you to do all for the glory of God. With all of your heart, joy is one of the basic elements of the ninefold fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5. And doing all for the glory of God is essential to the production of the spiritual fruit of joy in your life. Second, clarify your focus. Clarify your focus. Number one was do it enthusiastically with all your heart. Number two, clarify your focus. That is, keep Jesus Christ at the center. Fade out that question. What will other people think? You're glorifying the Lord, and you are doing it for him alone. Don't try to play spiritual politics by balancing part of your constituency against another part, like balancing God's standards against the standards of man, and then hoping that you're going to please them both. You can't do it. Do everything as unto the Lord and not unto men, is what Paul says in verse 23. You know, I made a resolution when I was a teenager that I really don't care what other people think about me. I only care what Jesus thinks. That will focus you. That will narrow your path. That will give you divine light for your walk. That will keep you from sin and from compromise. That will enable you to really do everything enthusiastically with joy as unto the Lord. I don't care what other people think. I only care what Jesus thinks. Make your choices on that basis, and you will do all for the glory of God. Verse 17 makes it clear that our words, as well as our actions, are in view when we do all to the glory of God. It says, and whatsoever ye do in word or deed. Verse 17 also makes it clear that what we do must be done with, now listen carefully, this is important, must be done with the authorization and authority of Jesus. Because it says, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Name speaks of authority, as in the phrase, open in the name of the law. The policeman knocks on the door and says, open in the name of the law. It's not because he's a big policeman. He may only weigh 90 pounds and may be a real weakling. But he has the authority of the law behind him. Open in the name of the law. Name speaks of authority. Often we close our prayers in the phrase, in Jesus' name, amen. Be careful that you are not forging the name of Jesus on a request that he would never grant, because it is contrary to his holy character. The charismatics are fond of shouting, in the name of Jesus, I command this or that. They use the name almost like a magic incantation. You cannot use the name of Jesus that way. That is an abuse of John chapter 14, verse 13. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. They're tied together here. The glorification of the Father, the name of Jesus, the fact that Jesus answers prayer. Let me give you an illustration of how that's an abuse. For example, pretend that you just had a fight with your friend Maria, and you are very mad at her. And so you pray this way, God, give Maria a horrible case of leprosy. In Jesus' name, amen. See, that's a blasphemous use of the name of Jesus. It's a blasphemous use of the promise that if we ask anything in his name, he will give it to us or do it for us. That's like forging the name of a millionaire on a bad check. The millionaire has not authorized you to write the check and to sign his name. You'll go to jail for that if you do it. So why do we think that we can forge the name of Jesus on our carnal prayers as though his name was some kind of a magic formula? Doing and saying things in the name of Jesus means that we are doing and saying them with his authorization and approval. They are things that Jesus himself would say or do. Jesus always did the will of his heavenly Father. That's why everything he did and said brought glory to God alone. Just attaching his name to something does not automatically glorify God. It may actually be an abuse of the name Jesus. So back for a moment to that resolution I made as a teenager, that I don't care what other people think of me, I only care what Jesus thinks of me. Listen carefully, because some people take that too far the other direction. That does not mean that we isolate ourselves from other believers because we don't care what they think. That's not what I'm talking about. Instead, it informs us of the kind of interaction with others that pleases and therefore glorifies God. I think that's self-evident because the next few verses tell us how to glorify God in our interpersonal relationships. Colossians 3:12. Put on, therefore, that third word is the word therefore. So whenever you see a therefore, ask what it is there for. Because doing all to the glory of God will result in specific external actions, words, thoughts, motives, and attitudes. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved. Now here's what you're supposed to put on. Bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long suffering. See, these are things that glorify God. These are the attitudes you build into your life. These are the responses that you have to other people. Forbearing one another, forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do you. Now listen, do you forgive other people who've hurt you? Do you forgive them the same way that Jesus forgave you? Would you want Jesus to forgive you the way that you're forgiving people who have offended you? Is that what you want? You see, we're developing the character of Christ here. And above all these things, put on charity. That's agape love. That's God's divine kind of love, which is the bond. That's what holds you together of perfectness. That's what makes you complete. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye thankful. Oh, that is so imperative. Let the peace of God rule. That word rule is a word for an umpire. One who makes the call at the plate. As the runner comes sliding into the plate, he either says, out or safe. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, the which also you're called in one body, and be ye thankful. And he goes on, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. These are things that you do for the glory of God. Teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Notice something. Music is cemented firmly in the center of that list. And it immediately precedes verse 17, which tells you that you're going to do all for the glory of God. Music! Young people, what kind of music? Older people, what kind of music are you listening to? What kind of music do you have playing in the background all the time when you're going about your daily activities? What do you have on your iPad and you got your earphone plugging in as you're walking down the street? Music is squarely in the center of the will of God. God is a musical being. The book of Zephaniah tells us that God sings over us. Not just that people sing to God. God sings. He is the author of music. What kind of music do you have? Does it glorify God? if I get preaching on that, I'm actually doing a whole series of about 10 weeks on music and the Bible. So I'm not going to get into that right now. But anyway, put on, therefore, as the elect of God. Everything that we do, everything that we say and think, and whatsoever ye do, verse 17, ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. And then it gets into some very personal interrelations. Here is where you're to glorify God. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as it is fit in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. You know, I've done a lot of marital counseling, and one of the things that I run across all the time is the wife who refuses to be obedient to her husband, and the husband who is bitter at his wife for what she refuses to do. We're talking about doing all to the glory of God. Your relationships in marriage must glorify God. Husbands, love your wives, and be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. Do you get it? Do all to the glory of God. This is the interpersonal relationships in the family. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Then he gets into business. Did you know you're supposed to do all to the glory of God in business? Look at it. Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service to just make it look good. As men pleasers, who do you want to please? I don't care what other people think. I only care what Jesus thinks. Is that your attitude? Not as men pleasers, you're a yes man, but with singleness of heart, fearing God. And here's our verse 23. We read it just a minute ago. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily. That is with a heart filled with absolute enthusiasm, as unto the Lord and not unto men. Care what Jesus thinks, don't care what people think. Knowing that of the Lord, we're going to stand before him someday. Knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Payday someday. Someday you will give an account for every word you've spoken. Jesus said so. Every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. You will give an account for every action that you ever did. You will give an account for every thought. You've got to bring every thought into captivity to the subjection of Jesus Christ. You will give an account for every bad attitude that you ever had. You will give an account for every wicked motive that you ever had, even if it looked good on the surface. You had candy-coated it over to make it the poison pill look like it was okay. Knowing that of someday, of the Lord, we receive the reward of the inheritance, for we serve the Lord Christ. Now get verse 25. But he that doeth wrong, and he's writing this to Christians. He's not talking about the unregenerate going to burn in hell. He's writing to Christians. He that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of persons. God doesn't play favorites. That's serious business, folks. You see why we're to do all to the glory of God? Because it has an impact on eternity. Did you notice how many other of the nine facets of the fruit of the Spirit were mentioned in that passage I just read you out of Colossians 3? By the way, some of my life verses, which I chose as a very young child, were verses 23 through 25 of Colossians 3. That's why I feel so passionate about this particular subject. But did you notice how many of the other nine facets of the fruit of the Spirit are mentioned in that passage about doing all to the glory of God? We saw joy in the word heartily, but there's also agape love, charity in verse 14. There's peace in verse 15. There's meekness and long-suffering in verse 12. I'll let you find the rest of them on your own. They're all there in Colossians chapter 3. The fruit of the Spirit, when you're in the center of the will of God, giving glory to God, the fruit of the Spirit will show up in your life. Doing all to the glory of God covers every area of interpersonal relations, and the Bible gives us specific, detailed actions, words, thoughts, motives, and attitudes that God says are for his glory and things that are not for his glory. They're instructions in Colossians 3 for interaction with other believers in the church. That's verse 13. For interaction between employers and employees. That's verse 22. For interaction between husbands and wives and children and parents. Fathers in particular and their children in verses 18 through 21. In other words, God has given us specific instructions as to how we are to do all to the glory of God. We don't have to guess. We don't have to make it up. God wants us to give him all the glory, so he has painstakingly set out for us the process step by step. In a nutshell, this is what's called living the Christian life, or walking in the Spirit, or walking by faith, progressive sanctification, if you want a theological term. It happens when we focus on doing, listen, every detail. Not just a big broad brushstroke, but doing every detail in a manner that is in conformity with the revealed will of God for the Christian life. We don't have time to mine the depths of the entire chapter on that in this message, but I think that'll give you a start, at least a little bit of a start, before going on, if you've never analyzed Colossians 3 in the context of how the practical Christian life gives glory to God through interpersonal relationships. I see I have 4 minutes. Another example of how our relationship with other believers glorifies God is seen in Romans 15:7. Wherefore, receive ye one another, as Christ also received us, to the glory of God. On one side of the coin, we see all creation, especially believers, bringing glory to God. On the opposite side of the coin, we see God manifesting his own glory. I have quite a few illustrations. I'll just tell you what they are. I will give you the reference so you can look up them later. God manifested his glory to Moses at the bush when he declared his covenant name. That's Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 14. We don't have time to read it. But that's the passage where God declares, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent me unto you. In John, chapter 8, 54 through 59, Jesus claimed to be the very God who spoke to Moses from the Shekinah glory at the bush, and the Jews wanted to stone him for blasphemy. Because Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, ego eimi, I am. He's claiming to be the God who spoke to Moses, and the Jews understood it, and they took up stones to stone him. God also manifested his glory. We are going to glorify God. Here's one side. God manifests his glory. That's the other side. Glory of God is our topic. God also manifested his glory to Isaiah in chapter 6 of Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon his throne, high and lifted up, his train filled the temple. He's surrounded by the seraphim. They're giving praise and glory to God, saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And did you know that just as the Shekinah glory of God connected Jesus to Abraham, even so, the Shekinah glory of God connected Jesus to the magnificent vision of glory in Isaiah 6. The Apostle John specifically says so in John 12, 41, where John says the glory of God in Isaiah was the glory of Jesus. That is, the saying of Isaiah, the prophet, might be fulfilled as he spake, Lord, who believed our report, and so on. And then it says, these things said Isaiah, John 12, 41, these things said Isaiah when he saw his, speaking of Jesus, saw his glory and spake of him. Isaiah saw Jesus' glory and spoke of Jesus. That's why Paul can declare in Philippians that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Now what's the last phrase? To the glory of God the Father. That's also, by the way, a quotation from Isaiah, and it's cited over in Romans chapter 4 as well. We don't have time for that, but that's Isaiah 45, 23, and Romans chapter 4, verse 11. God also, I have 2 minutes, God also manifested his glory to John in the book of Revelation. In fact, every chapter gives a different facet of the glory of God, but I'll give you one illustration. For example, chapter 15, the temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power, and no man was able to enter into the temple until the 7 plagues of the 7 angels were fulfilled. Revelation 21, 11, having the glory of God, her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. Chapter 21, verse 23, the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it. And we've already seen that the Lamb is the one who shines forth the glory, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
other ways in which God is glorified. I'm just going to read these through for you. I'm not going to give you, I'll mention the references, but I won't read them all. God is glorified when the word of God is glorified, 2 Thessalonians 3:1. God is glorified by creation, Psalm 19:1, the heavens declare the glory of God. The restoration of the nation Israel brings glory to God, and we have a whole list of those, and those will be in the printed form when it comes out. God is glorified when he judges the heathen. God is glorified in the miracles of Christ. We have many verses that talk about that, how God received glory through the miracles of Christ. God is glorified when believers bear the fruit of the Spirit. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. That takes us back to being in the center of God's will. God is glorified when we exercise our spiritual gifts, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11. God is glorified when we offer him thanksgiving. All things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace through the thanksgiving of many may redound to the glory of God. God is glorified in the works of our Lord Jesus Christ and in the believer. God is glorified when believers patiently suffer for Christ. God is glorified through the keeping of his promises. God will be glorified in the believers when Christ comes at the rapture. Those who covet the glory of God for themselves or refuse to glorify him are under his wrath. Satan, the rebellious angel, coveted the glory of God for himself and is under judgment. That's Isaiah chapter 14 and Ezekiel chapter 28. Men who refuse to glorify God are under his judgment. For the wrath of God, Romans 1:18, is revealed from heaven to heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth. That's a word for a wrestling term for suppressing the truth in unrighteousness. Because that, when they knew God, now listen, here are the two things that the pagans refused to do. And as a result, they're under the judgment of God. Because that, when they knew God, number one, they glorified him not as God. Number two, neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. Their foolish hearts was darkening, and so God turned them over to such horrible things as we see listed there in Romans chapter 1. But after all that study, we've only scratched the surface of glory to God alone. I'm closing down. Almost done. Although it's a subject for another time, did you catch that connection between giving glory and giving thanks? It says, in everything, that's the same as doing all. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning somebody else. Is that what it says? Concerning you, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. In other words, it's directly parallel to giving glory to God alone. Those are the two things which God requires of man. Both cover everything. Giving glory to God deals with his person. Giving thanks to God deals with his work, his person and his work. The message that I was ultimately planning to preach first, which is now going to be second, during that message, we're going to talk about how everything in that message centers on the person and work of Christ. Giving glory to God is to his person. Giving thanks to God relates to his work. The gospel relates to the person and work of Jesus Christ. And so the pagans are lost and they're headed for hell because giving glory to God and thanksgiving are the two things the pagans refuse to do. And so God turns them over to the sodomy and filthiness that you see in Romans 1. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were they thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Soli Deo Gloria, glory to God alone. So ask the question, are we personally, individually, and accountably living that way every day with every fiber of our being? God never gives us a command, but that he also gives us the divine enablement to obey it. God has given you his word so that you will know what he requires. He has given you his Holy Spirit so that you have the necessary power to do it. Does that great command, do all to the glory of God, inform every deed, word, thought, attitude, and motive in your life? Does this unchanging command by Almighty God control all of our interpersonal relationships with spouse and children, other family members, the church, the unregenerate world around us, and our approach to all of life? Does it shift our focus to the divine viewpoint, our interaction and choices? Choices have consequences, people. I tell my congregation that all the time. Every little choice you make will have a consequence. Does it so focus our interaction and choices in the temporal world, or do we need to repent? I think many in the church do. Do we need to repent and begin walking by faith and obedience to the clearly revealed will of God? And whatsoever you do,